I'm Dr. Neelam Pawar, pediatric ophthalmologist from Arvind Eye Hospital, India, and I will be talking on epidemic of childhood myopia, global perspective and management strategies. And I will be glad to have queries at the end of the presentation. So myopia has become a global public health burden with its increasing prevalence in both developing and developed countries. And recent publications and researches have added valuable information in the literature, which have changed the management and perspective of childhood myopia. So this lecture will focus on treatment modalities with specific emphasis on pharmacologic therapy of progressive myopia. We'll also discuss about prevalence and epidemiology of myopia. It will highlight recent findings on preventive and early interventional measures to retard myopia and novel treatments for progression of myopia. So here's the poll question one. What is your current position? Are you a pediatric ophthalmologist? Are you a comprehensive ophthalmologist? Are you a fellow or a resident, medical student, optometrist, or a myopia consultant? So let's just see who all have joined us today. Yeah, it's good to see that most of you are comprehensive ophthalmologist and optometrist. Few of you are medical student and pediatric ophthalmologist. And great to see that some of you are doing myopia consultant. Brian Holden Vision Institute is a non-profit, non-governmental organization in Sydney, Australia, and it is doing wonderful work on myopia and has established as a global myopia center. Brian Holden Vision Institute held a meeting in 2015 with international myopia experts, which led to the formation of International Myopia Institute. And this International Myopia Institute published white papers, which were highlighted in special issue of IOVS 2019. The seven reports which were generated were on classification and definition of myopia, experimental models of emetropathization and myopia, myopia genetics, myopia progression, myopia clinical trials, industry guidelines and ethical consideration, myopia clinical trials, and myopia control progression management. So all the pediatric ophthalmologists and general ophthalmologists should one time go through these seven white papers, which will be beneficial for them. Brian Holden Vision Institute estimated that in 2010, 1.9 billion people of the world's population were myopic and 70 million of them were high myopic. These numbers are projected to rise to 52% and 10% respectively by 2050. If we see global prevalence of myopia and temporal trends from 2000 through 2050, it is obvious that every region from Asia, Europe, Western Europe, North America, Southern Latin America, and Southern Africa will see a surge of myopia, which will be almost double of the existing prevalence of myopia. Vision impairment related to myopia can have significant economic impact not only on the individual, but also on nation in terms of cost of contact lenses, spectacle, cost of refractive surgery, and myopia-related complication surgery. Vision impairment has also significant effect on quality of life regarding patients' physical, emotional, and social functioning. And globally, the economic burden is estimated to be around $202 billion per year, which is huge. Here's the poll question two. Do you think pediatric myopia needs consideration of an epidemic? Yes, no, or not sure. Great to see that 78% of the people think that myopia needs a consideration of an epidemic. And that's why all of us are today here. 17% of you are not sure whether to consider it as a myopia. Myopia is a complex disease. The causes of myopia are multifactorial, and it results due to combination of genetic and environmental and microenvironmental factors. With the advent of genome-wide association studies, different refractive error genes have been identified, which are involved in retinal cascade signaling. Various myopia-associated loci that are involved in neurotransmission, ion transport, retinoic acid metabolism, extracellular matrix remodeling, and eye development have been identified. The Consortium for Refractive Error and Myopia, which was the largest ever conducted international genome study, found that various genomic variations are associated with tenfold increase in the prevalence of myopia. 23andMe, which is again a large genome study group, also found different genes of myopia related to visual cycle and neuronal development in myopia. The International Myopia Institute, in its Myopia Genetic Report, states that to date, almost 200 genetic loci have been identified in myopia, and some are common refractive error genes, while some are syndromic myopic genes. While some of them are overlapping in these two groups. So if you see the prevalence of myopia, it is obvious that it is 20-30% in white population, and prevalence is as high as 80-90% in East Asian population. The onset of myopia is earlier and progression is more in Asian population compared to European population and white population. So let's see what are the risk factors associated with myopia. Parental myopia is an important risk factor, and in a recent study, which is population-based pediatric eye disease consortium, which was based on four different multi-ethnic population from Singapore, Sydney, Los Angeles, and Baltimore study, showed that children having myopic parents were at higher risk of myopia before school age group. An individual has a 2.08 times greater chance of becoming myopic if he or she had one myopic parent, and this increases to 5.07 times greater chance with two myopic parents. A recent study published in IOVS found that there was no association between sleep duration and bedtime with myopia progression in 4-year follow-up of Chinese children. While a study done long back showed that when controlling for age, parental myopia, weight, and gender, the taller Singapore Chinese children were having high axial length, while children with high BMI were having hyperopic refraction. The CHAM study, which is Childhood Health Activity and Motor Performance Eye Study, done in Danish children, in this study, the prevalence of myopia was not associated with any physical activity. Let's come to poll question 3. Do you record parental myopia history, time spent on screen, and exposure to sunlight when dealing with a myopic patient? Always, yes, sometimes, never. Yeah, it's good to see that 45% of you are saying that sometimes they record these parameters, while 44% of you are always recording this, and 11% said that they never record parental myopia history and time spent on screen. New work is also an important factor associated with myopia. The Sydney Myopia Study found that near work such as close reading distance of less than 30 centimeters and continuous reading of more than 30 minutes independently increased the odds of having myopia. The participants of Sydney Myopia Study Group were followed in Sydney Adolescent Vascular and Eye Study. And this study found that children who became myopic performed significantly more near work compared with children who remained non-myopic. And this was significant in cohort of 6 years, while it was not significant in cohort of 12 years of age. This point highlighted the fact that near work can be a factor for inducing the earlier onset of myopia in smaller children. Whether screen is an important risk factor in development of myopia. So there are mixed evidence showing association between digital screen time and myopia. While recent studies in 2017 and 19 are in favor that more is the time spent on digital screen, more is the myopia prevalence. Less time spent outdoors is also an important risk factor, and various longitudinal study of parents and children and childhood population eye study done in children aged 8 to 15 year found that less is the time spent outdoor, more is the incident of myopia. Higher education is also considered an important risk factor. Competitive and stressful education system and higher education of parents leads to increase in rise of myopia. So risk factors, just we'll see what are the risk factors responsible for myopia development. In a recent article published in BMC Ophthalmology, it reviewed on the epidemiology of myopia in school children worldwide. And the common risk factor associated with prevalence of myopia listed were female gender, low outdoor activity, parental myopia, increasing age, time spent on near work and studying, higher socioeconomic status, urban environment, high population density, and small home size were also considered important risk factor. This study came out with a very interesting fact that use of LED lamps for homework compared to incandescent or fluorescent lamp increased the risk of myopia. Private schooling and watching TV over 2 hours daily and playing mobile and video games led to the increased rise of myopia. Lower vitamin D levels, less participation in sport, and westernized dietary habits were responsible for development of myopia. The nature and nurture plays an important role in development of myopia. The Generation R study provide evidence that nature and nurture are equally important in myopia development and axial length and corneal radius ratio. Since myopia genes are common in population, so adjustment of lifestyle should be major focus in the prevention of myopia. Whether vitamin D is associated with myopia. So first, in a longitudinal study of European children, serum vitamin D was not found to be associated between time outdoors and myopia. And second, in a Mendelian randomization study by Green Consortium, no relationship was found between vitamin D and myopia. However, Tang et al. In a meta-analysis published in 2019 reported that lower 25-hydroxyvitamin D concentration is associated with increased risk of myopia. And there are two theories behind it. The light dopamine theory, which suggests that increased light intensity during time spent outdoor protects against myopia by increased release of dopamine. And vitamin D theory suggested that increased UV light triggers the stimulation of vitamin D, which helps in prevention of myopia. Zinc, copper, selenium, manganese of vitamin E, vitamin C, glutathione, and beta carotene. They play an important role in the antioxidative process and in biochemical rebuilding of sclera, and thus helps in prevention of axial elongation. Well, a recent research came with a very interesting point that dietary vitamin A was not associated with myopia from adolescent to young adulthood. So what causes myopia? The signaling cascade from the retina to the sclera is held responsible. Amacrine cells are implicated in retinal processing of the signal. The choroid and sclera show biochemical changes which are associated with ocular growth in the animal models. Choroid is an important source of scleral growth regulator, and the local visual stimuli, whenever there's a local visual stimuli, choroid respond to emetropathization and axial length elongation. So quantitative measurement of choroidal thickness by imaging diagnostic modality in future can be helpful to understand the relationship between thin choroids and retinal complications of the elongated myopic eye. Is there any relationship between beta peripapillary atrophy and myopic progression? A recent article published in Eye Journal found that children with young age and smaller beta peripapillary atrophy at baseline showed a faster myopic progression, and the width of the beta peripapillary atrophy can be used as quantitative parameter for further myopia progression. So in this example A, the beta peripapillary zone is small, but this patient later showed the myopia progression. While in the second picture, the beta peripapillary atrophy is wide, but this child on follow-up didn't show any axial elongation. So hence, the width of the beta peripapillary atrophy can be potential parameter for further myopia progression. The well-known complications of myopia are myopic macular degeneration, myopic choroidal neovascularization, retinal detachment, glaucoma, and cataract. And most of the study found the prevalence of these myopia degeneration are common in high myopia. Although high myopia carries the highest risk of complications and visual impairment, low and moderate myopia also have considerable risk. So these estimates should alert policy makers, health industry, government and non-government organization, and healthcare professionals to make myopia a priority for prevention and treatment, so that low and moderate myopia are not converted to high myopia. The treatment of myopia progression consists of optical, which can be in form of single vision spectacle, progressive addition lenses, ortho-K, soft contact lenses, multifocal contact lenses, pharmacological in form of atropine drops, perenzepine, timolol drops, behavioral modification by increasing outdoor and decreasing screen time. Surgical treatment is not advocated in treatment of progression of myopia and is not preferred, and combination of all these treatments can be used. The peripheral, increasing peripheral hyperopic defocus is known to be an important factor in development of myopia, and orthokeratology and soft multifocal contact lenses slow the myopia progression by optically decreasing this peripheral hyperopic defocus or by increasing the peripheral myopic blur. So Blink study was demonstrated that increase in peripheral refraction in myopic children with bifocal lenses can be helpful in preventing progression of myopia. The correction of myopia evaluation trial study was a multi-center randomized controlled clinical trial, and the aim of study was to find whether there is any difference in the progression of myopia between children wearing progressive addition lenses versus conventional single vision lenses. So a small statistically significant amount of difference was found during the first year, but the size of treatment remained similar for the next 2 years. So the small magnitude of the effect does not warrant a change in the clinical practice. While these progressive addition lenses were effective in slowing progression in children who had larger accommodative lags, and difference was statistically significant throughout 3 years. The US COMET trial, Hong Kong trial, and Japanese trial collectively, all these three clinical trials showed that progressive addition lenses are largely ineffectual modality for myopia progression. Greater success has been reported recently with executive bifocals and prismatic bifocal spectacles in decreasing the myopia progression. Orthokeratology shows some promising result. In first trial, the retardation of myopia in orthokeratology study, the axial elongation was slowed by an average of 43%, which was larger in younger patient and with more rapidly progressive myopic children. The longitudinal orthokeratology research in children study also showed promising result, and orthokeratology was effective in high myopia and cases with astigmatism. The only concern with these ortho-K lenses is the increased incidence of microbial keratitis. Soft multifocal contact lenses and orthokeratology slowed myopia progression by an average of 46% and 43% respectively. Along with soft contact lenses and multifocal contact lenses, there are some study which shows that rigid gas permeable contact lenses also slows the progression of myopia. Now let's come to the pharmacological treatment. Atropine is a broadband muscarinic acetylcholine receptor antagonist, and it prevents myopia via a non-accommodative mechanism. So how it exerts its anti-myopia effect? There is a neurosignaling cascade system which causes myopia, and it begins at the retina level. And atropine drops are thought to be acting on these presynaptic and postsynaptic muscarinic receptor. But still, the exact mechanism is not clear. In a landmark study done in Singapore, which was the ATOM-1 study, Atropine for Treatment of Childhood Myopia study, which included 400 Asian children in age group of 6 to 12 years with myopia of minus 1 to minus 6 diopter. This study found that eyes treated with atropine 1% experienced reduction in refractive error chain and axial length. And in follow-up of ATOM-2 study, a similar effective dose-dependent result with lower concentration of atropine was seen with reduction in side effects of glare and discomfort. The phase 2 of ATOM study found that there was a rapid rebound increase when atropine was stopped for 12 months, and the rebound effect was less with lower concentration of atropine. In phase 3 of ATOM, those cases which have rebound effect were restarted on atropine 0.01%. So whether lower concentration of atropine works, the LAMP study, which is low concentration atropine for myopia progression, suggested that 0.05% atropine may be most effective concentration for myopia control. So what are the guidelines for using atropine drops? The clinical guidelines for children aged 6 to 10 years with myopia more than 1 diopter and with a documented myopic progression of more than 0.5 diopter per year, treat children with atropine 0.01% for 2 years. If there is good response and almost no myopic progression, that is, there is less than 0.5 diopter increment over second year, then taper and stop atropine. If there is a moderate response, that is myopia progression of 0.5 diopter to 1 diopter over second year. Continue atropine 0.01% for further 1-2 years and then taper and stop atropine. If there is a poor response, that is, there's a myopic progression of more than 1 diopter over second year, so these cases may be non-responder, so consider tapering and stop atropine. The role of 1% atropine in these non-responder is still not so well known. So the outcome measures are seen as changes in spherical equivalent refractive error and changes in axial length. The ATOM 3 study, which is still under trial, included patients with parental history of myopia, patient with pre-myopia, and those patients with spherical equivalent of minus 0.5 diopter or even less. This, they are also being treated with atropine 0.01%. So what is the non-Asian perspective? The atropine drops are widely used in Asian countries and atropine drops are easily available. While in non-Asian countries, they are not so frequently used because of off-label use of atropine drops. So there are a number of ongoing placebo-controlled trial of 0.01% atropine currently undergoing in United Kingdom, Ireland and Western Australia. The eye journal highlighted the summarization of Cochrane reports as Cochrane Corner, atropine, an ancient remedy for a 21st century problem. In a meta-analysis of Cochrane database of systematic reviews on intervention to slow progression of myopia in children. And this was the review study published in 2016. And it showed that atropine was most effective at slowing myopia progression compared to all other interventions, including refractive method. However, a dose response effect was not shown. So when myopia treatment should be implemented and on which children? The average growth of eye in childhood is 0.2 millimeter per year and ATOM studies recommended that treatment with atropine 0.01% should be initiated if myopia progression exceeds 0.5 diopter the preceding year. And this corresponds to elongation greater than 0.2 millimeter. Progression is faster in younger children and those of East Asian ethnicity and those with a parental history of myopia. So even atropine drops should be instilled earlier in these children. When myopia treatment should be discontinued and when to stop the treatment. Assuming the myopia control is effective, it should be continued as long as benefit outweigh the potential risk or additional cost associated with the myopia treatment. A recent survey conducted among pediatric ophthalmologists worldwide to decrease myopia progression reported that 80% of the pediatric ophthalmologists prescribed 0.01% atropine, while 13% of pediatric ophthalmologists uses 1% of atropine. For optical therapies, 23% of pediatric ophthalmologists prescribe progressive addition lenses, while 21% fits orthokeratology. Among the pharmacological treatment offered, European physicians were offering the lowest rate. Behavioral modifications were advised in 92% cases, while 95% of pediatric ophthalmologists preferred combination of all this treatment. In a review meeting in 2018 by WHO, International Association of Prevention of Blind Ness and Brian Holden Vision Institute, they came to a common consensus that pharmacological therapy is most effective in myopia control intervention, followed by orthokeratology and multifocal contact lenses. RGP lenses and peripheral defocus lenses were less promising, while under correction should not be advocated at all. So what is the future of myopia treatment? Cooper Vision MiSight daily contact lenses have shown promising results. Eyenovia is already in phase 3 with micropine as atropine microformulation drop. Defocus incorporated multiple segment spectacle lenses have shown to slow down the myopia progression. Sightglass Vision multicentral trial is still under study. So what are the behavioral treatment? Behavioral treatment should be advised along with pharmacologic treatment. Ophthalmologists should advise to decrease screen time, to increase outdoor time, and schools should make effort to take some classes outside. Recess should be in outside playground, and there should be daily some recreational outdoor activities in school. So not any light is just sufficient for prevention of myopia, and myopia follows more than 1000 lux rules. The children spending greater time exposed to bright outdoor lighting condition more than 1000 lux showed significant slower myopic progression. Seasonal fluctuation can alter myopia progression. So not only the light quality, but light parameter should be considered in treatment of myopia. What are the benefits of behavioral intervention? Behavioral intervention avoids side effects of atropine and orthokeratology. And general guidelines are that children should engage in outdoor activities for at least 2 to 3 hours per day and at least 14 to 21 hours per week. Less than 40 minutes per day of bright exposure may predispose children to faster axial length growth. Here is the poll question 4. What myopia treatment do you prefer for your patients? Single vision spectacles or lenses, progressive addition lenses, atropine 0.01%, orthokeratology, combination therapy of pharmacological drops and behavior treatment, multifocal contact lenses, and any other modalities. Let's see what people have opined. So most of you are advocating a combination therapy of pharmacological drop and behavior treatment followed by single vision lenses. Very few of you are advising progressive addition lenses and orthokeratology, while atropine 0.01% accounts for 14%. So these are the guidelines for myopia management, nicely briefed by Brian Holden Vision Institute. So whenever a patient of myopia comes to your clinic, you should take a detailed history, including family history, the time spent on outdoor activities and near work, age of onset and progression, visual acuity both uncorrected and best corrected, binocular vision status, corneal topography in cases of ortho-K lenses, anterior eye examination, intraocular pressure, objective and subjective cycloplegic refraction, there is no substitute for cycloplegic refraction, and fundus examination. So there is an increased risk of onset of myopia if one or both parents are myopic, patients with East Asian ethnicity, those with excessive near work and limited outdoor activities, and if myopia progression is more than 0.75 diopter per year. And there is increased risk of progression if onset of myopia is at 9 years or less than 9 years, with parental history of myopia, progression of more than 0.75 diopter per year, and East Asian ethnicity. So management consists if there is no myopia and child is at risk of myopia, reduce the risk by increasing time outdoors and frequent breaks from near work. For myopia, choose a myopia control strategy and consider patient suitability, patient and carer preference, effectiveness of strategy, and assistive strategy. If you're planning for no control, single vision spectacle and single vision contact lenses can be given. Myopia control can be done by providing contact lenses, ortho-K lenses, progressive addition lenses, executive bifocal, peripheral defocus lenses, low-dose atropine, and combination of low-dose atropine with multifocal contact lenses. And these children should be followed at 1 week, 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, and 12 months in cases when you have started child on atropine drops or when you have started on vision contact lenses. While in children whom you are prescribing only single vision spectacle, follow-up can be done at 6 months or 12 months. So in every follow-up, just check the anterior segment examination, pupil size and response to light, intraocular pressure, subjective and objective refraction to be done at every 6 months, and fundus examination can be done annually. So if progression is not slowed, check the lens prescription, check the compliance, and consider changing the treatment plan or design or treatment modality. And if myopia is stable for at least 1 year, observe for 2 years before considering cessation of myopia control. The biometry in myopic eyes can be done by conventional ultrasound biometry by A-scan, which was done in ATOM study done in Singapore. It can be done by optical biometry by partial coherence interferometry by IOLMaster 500 and by IOLMaster 700 and LensStar. The advantage of these non-contact biometry is that they give accurate measurements of axial length, anterior chamber depth, and IOLMaster 700 also gives us pupil measurement. So a child can be followed with before starting the treatment and after starting the treatment, pupil size can be determined with IOLMaster 700. The poll question 5, do you perform biometry, pupil size measurement and accommodation amplitudes in all pediatric patients who are taking myopia control treatment? Yes, most of the time, or not at all. So let's see what people are responding. 62% of you are saying that you don't perform biometry, pupil size measurement, and accommodation amplitude, while it is good to see that 38% of you perform all these measurements before taking any myopia control treatment. So what are the criteria for instillation of atropine drop? Age should be around 6 to 13 years. Spherical equivalent of ranging from minus 0.50 to minus 6 diopter, with a myopia progression of minus 0.5 diopter per year. There should be no history of atropine allergy, and there should be no anisometropia of more than minus 1 or minus 1.5 diopter. The role of atropine drops in pathological myopia, syndromic myopia, and pseudophakic myopia, and myopia in lasered ROP is still questionable. So at baseline, you should see for near point of convergence, near point of accommodation, negative relative accommodation and positive relative accommodation, pupil size, exhale length measurement, keratometry, op scan if possible, cycloplegic refraction. And on follow-up, check for side effect, check whether there is need of progressive addition lenses, check pupillary response to light, and ask about glare and check near vision. Regularly educate patient on how to instill drop, and patient should be reminded in every visit that these atropine drops are not magic drops, and lifestyle modification should always be done along with these pharmacological treatment. Let's see an example of rebound effect of 0.01% atropine. This child came to us at initial examination. He had -4 diopter of myopia in both eyes, and he was showing a progression of more than -0.5 diopter. And when he reached -5 diopter, we started him on atropine 0.01% drop. And at its baseline, exit length was 25.78 millimeter in right eye, and in left eye it was 25.92 millimeter in 2018. Patient took treatment for almost 2 years and compliance was good. And when the treatment was stopped, within 4 months, the myopia rises from -5 to -6.5, and exit length in right eye increased to 26.71 millimeter, and in left eye to 26.46 millimeter. So this suggests that rebound effect of even 0.01% atropine can be seen, and therefore patient should be followed periodically. And if any rebound effect is there, they should be started on atropine drops. So for this particular patient, we started again on atropine drops. The myopia calculator is a beneficial tool given by Brian Holden Vision Institute, and it is useful to visualize the average potential outcome based on research. And if you log in into this myopia calculator here, you will see ethnicity, and right now it is only for Asian and non-Caucasian population. Child age in years, refractive error, and what myopia management option you are going to plan. So by entering all these details, the calculator will give you what is the myopia progression at the age of 17 years. Here the red line indicates the myopia progression at age of 17 years, and this green line shows what will be the effect of myopia treatment on the refractive error. So let's see an example. This child came to us in 2013 at age of 7 years. He was having refraction of -1.5 diopter sphere and -0.50 cylinder in both eyes. And in 2019, at age of 14 years, his myopia increased, and he had -5 diopter sphere spherical with -0.50 cylinder in right eye, and -4.50 diopter sphere and -0.50 cylinder in left eye. So if I enter these details in myopia calculator, it showed that at age of 17 years, if any myopia treatment is not started, child will end up with myopia of 6.68 diopter. And if atropine drops would have been advocated in initial phase, this myopia could have been reduced to just -3.62 diopter. So unfortunately, atropine was not available that time, but right now the child is on myopia treatment. The World Society of Pediatric Ophthalmologists and Strabismus Society gave a myopia consensus statement that under correction does not work. What probably does not work is also bifocals and contact lenses. What might work is orthokey lenses and peripheral retinal defocus, and what does actually work is atropine eye drops. So if we see the myopia control in 2020, in the first 6 months of 2020, there were more than 15 papers on myopia and myopia progression. And these evidences are enough to show that myopia has reached a stage of an epidemic and it needs a serious management. Ophthalmologist and optometrist should work in collaboration with schools and school administrators and along with government and non-governmental organization to have a pediatric myopia referral system, and should have programs like National Myopia Program and should have Myopia Awareness Week, so to create and increase awareness in myopic patients and parents of myopia so that myopia progression can be delayed or can be treated. So the future of your myopic patient lies in your hands. Choose best myopic treatment for your pediatric patient, their future of your country. A pandemic has taught us a lot. An epidemic of myopia can be dealt if ophthalmologists and optometrists are at frontline. Simple myopia is not so simple, but it needs a serious approach for its treatment. Thank you very much, and thank you, CyberSight. And I hope so you enjoyed this lecture on myopia progression. And thanks, CyberSight, for giving this opportunity to present. And if we can take any questions. Yeah, so there's a question. What is the earliest age of a child that you can start low-dose atropine? So if you see the published studies, most of the studies advocate that child should achieve ametropization, and only once the child has achieved ametropization, then only the myopia treatment should be started. So the minimum age limit is 6 years, and maximum age is 13 to 14 years. Why only one study has shown that they started atropine drop in 5 years of age? So there's another question. Do you recommend diluting atropine drops? I don't think so. It is a good idea to dilute atropine drops because then the efficacy of these prepared drops is not well established, and I don't think so whether they will be, it will be helpful in reducing the progression. What is the earliest age when you can start contact lenses in a child? It depends on the parent. Sometimes we discuss all these options with parent, and it depends upon how child is cooperative. Even with ortho-K lenses, they can be given at an earlier age, but if child is not cooperative, then better to start contact lenses at a later age. So this one more question, are there any data or studies done in Black or African countries? Yes, I am not aware about atropine drop usage in Black or African communities, but there are some studies in which African living in another countries, they have shown promising results. with atropine drops. There's another question. Do you use atropine in slowing the progression of childhood myopia in your clinic? And if so, what dose and for how long? So ideally, we start the atropine treatment after the age of 6. And if child is showing a progression of more than 0.5 diopter per year, and we start with low dose atropine, 0.01%, and one drop daily at night for 2 years. And if there is no progression, then only we stop the atropine treatment. But as I have shown in the example, there can be rebound effect even if there is a stable refraction. So even after 2 years, if patient is showing a rebound effect, you can again restart the treatment. Atropine 0.01% is quite safe drop, and we rarely see any potentially harmful complication. So they can be continued for long time. But it depends. It depends on the iris color and light intensity in different countries. For Asian population, it really works. So are there any studies that confirm if myopia come before the near work or the near work occurs as a result of myopia? Most of the studies shows that earlier the child start reading, or earlier the child start doing near work for more than 30 minutes, earlier is the onset of myopia. And it is quite evident in Asian population, where the robust education system pushes them to early education at 2.5 to 3 years of age. They are subjected to read books. This may be the cause that in Asian population, we see the onset of myopia at an early age compared to Western and European population. So what is microenvironment? Microenvironment includes all the things like the light intensity of bulbs, living in small houses, even in your environment, which can act as a risk factor, we include those as microenvironment. This one, another question, full correction or under correction, which one is the best way for the correction of myopic patient? So 10 to 15 years back, the hypothesis was you should under correct the patient to prevent the increase in myopia. But this theory is absolutely obsolete now. And the current trend is that every child should be given prescription, which is should be given full myopic progression, because under correction again acts as a stimulus factor for increase in axial elongation and leads to myopia. There's another question. What do you think about the use of cross-linking to retard the progress of high myopia? That's good. There are some surgical interventions reported by International Myopia Institute group research papers, and there are few studies which shows that cross-linking of the sclera can lead to decrease in the can lead to decrease in axial elongation. There's another question. Do you combine progressive lenses with atropine 0.01% therapy? Usually we don't combine, but there's no harm in combining progressive lenses with atropine 0.01% therapy. Progressive bifocal lens as individual don't work so well, but along with atropine 0.01%, they could be beneficial. They could actually help child in reading and doing near work. Though most of the child, they never complain that they are having any near work problem. Only few children, they are having problem in reading. So in those cases, this combination will work perfect. I think for rest of the questions, we have already answered and we have already discussed in my presentation. There's another question. So you confirm that progressive addition lenses are not better than single vision lenses in prevention of myopia progression? Yeah, but this does not fit for all patients. You have to check the accommodative amplitudes, and if patient is having higher or larger lag of accommodation, progressive addition lenses can be beneficial. So another question, once the myopia has onset, outdoor activity does not help. Yeah, there's a report by one author who says that once the myopia has onset, the role of outdoor activity does not play any role in progression of myopia. There are published study which proves this theory to be wrong, and any amount of outdoor activity can help in reducing the myopia progression. Definitely it will not decrease it to a more level once the myopia has onset, but regular outdoor activities, as I said, that more than 40 minutes of daily outdoor activity can definitely help in decreasing the myopia progression. So there's another question, what constitutes a responder versus non-responder to atropine therapy? Do we base it solely on 1 to 2 years of trial of therapy? Yeah, to say a patient is a responder or non-responder, it is not just in terms of 1 or 2 years. We have to see the myopic progression. If on treating the patient with atropine drops, if there is no improvement within 1 year, and if the progression is more than 1 diopter per year, then definitely it is a failure of treatment, and those cases can be considered as non-responder. So how would you taper off atropine drops? Atropine drops are usually given on daily basis at night, and these can be tapered off by giving atropine drops first for few months, only for 5 days in a week. Then they can be tapered slowly for 4 days, 3 days, 2 days, and 1 day per week. And slowly it can be stopped. So I think we are done with most of the questions, and any other questions we can discuss with you in we can discuss you by email. So thanks again for joining us today for this CyberSight live webinar, and stay safe. Thank you.